students, welcome back to the class. Hope you remember what we were studying. We were talking about cell, the unit of life, chapter 8 in your textbook. Okay, so I think you remember what we learned last time. We had learned about the definition of a cell, what is cell. Yes, then we learned about the brief discovery about the cell, and in the end we had also learned about cell theory. Now today what we are going to learn is an overview of the cell. Now what is meant by an overview? Overview means a brief description or summary of something. So here we are going to briefly understand about the structure of a cell. Okay, so in all living organisms, beginning from Monera to the kingdom Animalia, all the living organisms have in their cells the following three important components. Now let us see what are those important components. These components are the outer envelope, second the genetic material, and finally the cytoplasm. Okay, now let's take each one step by step. The first one is the outer envelope. Each and every cell would be having an outer envelope, a covering, a boundary. Okay, so and that outer membrane is referred to as the plasma membrane or the plasma lemma, or also referred to as the cell membrane. Okay, now if I draw a cell, now when we draw a cell, how do we draw? We draw a cell like this, and whenever we draw a cell, we always make a boundary line. Now this boundary represents the plasma membrane. This is the plasma membrane. Now this picture that you see here on the screen is the magnified image of the plasma membrane. Now this image could be learned only after the invention of the electron microscope. So this is actually an electron microscopic picture of the plasma membrane, which we can't see it under a simple compound microscope. So this is how a plasma membrane looks like. We shall be discussing about the details of the structure of plasma membrane later on in our coming videos. Okay, so every cell will be surrounded by a plasma membrane or the plasma lemma. Now let us discuss about the function of the plasma membrane. What are the important functions of plasma membrane? Now see here, it being the outermost covering, it is actually referred to as a protective barrier to the cell. That is, it protects the interior of the cell from the exterior. Secondly, it regulates the transport of substances in and out of the cell. Now see, cell has a specific environment, but at the same time, the cell is continuously doing metabolic activities or chemical reactions in order to maintain life. So it requires a lot of materials from outside, as well as the materials that are synthesized within it. It should also be moving out of the cell. For that purpose, things from the exterior surface needs to enter into the cell, as well as things from inside the cell should also move out. And this thing is regulated. Now anything can't just simply enter into the cell. Likewise, anything can't simply move out of the cell. What has to come in and what has to go out is determined by the plasma membrane. We say the plasma membrane is selectively permeable. That is, it regulates only specific type of transport transportation to take place. It allows only specific molecules to enter in and out of the cell. So that is one very important function of the plasma membrane, regulating the transport of substances in and out of the cell. Especially in multicellular organisms, cell-to-cell communication and recognition occurs through plasma membrane. Okay, so cell-to-cell communication and recognition. How will a cell know that I am lying in the vicinity of another cell which is belonging to my type? How do they communicate with each other? Again, this communication happens because of the components present on the plasma membrane, about which we shall study in the next videos to come. Then finally, the important function of the plasma membrane is to provide anchoring sites for the filaments of the cytoskeleton. To understand it, let us go back to the previous slide. So in this picture you have seen, you can see some filaments lying over here, and they are anchored or they are attached to the plasma membrane. These are referred to as a cytoskeleton. Cytoskeletons are proteinaceous filaments present in the cytoplasm, and one of the important functions is they provide a specific shape to the cell. So, and these cytoskeletons are actually anchored or attached to the plasma membrane. So these are the important functions of the plasma membrane. Okay, so let us again learn it. It acts as a protective barrier. Secondly, regulates the transport of substances in and out of the cell. It is also involved in cell-to-cell communication and recognition in order to work together in tissues. And finally, provides anchoring sites for cytoskeleton. Now, in some organisms, like belonging to organisms belonging to the kingdom Plantae, fungi, some protists, and most of the monerals, other than the plasma membrane, they are further covered by, this plasma membrane is further covered by cell wall. Now, the cell wall would be absent in animal cell, except in the animal kingdom, all other kingdoms would be having cell wall. Of course, you will be having that in plant, and you know that in plants it is made up of cellulose. In fungi, it is made up of chitin. Likewise, in protists, some protists, not all protists, some protists contain the cell wall. Likewise, even monerals. But the composition, the chemical nature of the cell wall would be varying from plants, fungi, protists, and monerals. They will be differing in each other. Is that understood? So, along with the plasma membrane, in some other organisms, their cells may also contain cell wall outer to the plasma membrane. So, what is the function of the cell wall? The function of the cell wall is to provide rigidity and shape to the cells. It provides protection, rigidity, and shape to the cell. Okay, so that is about the cell wall. So, as I told you, all the organisms will be made up of cell, and all the cells that these organisms have would be having a membrane referred to as plasma membrane, which all organisms will be having. Whereas in some organisms belonging to kingdom Plantae, fungi, protists, and monerans will also have an extra covering outside the plasma membrane referred to as the cell wall. The second important component of all the cell is the genetic material. Genetic material. It represents the hereditary material that not only controls the functioning of the cell but has all the information required for making the whole organism. Okay, so and you know that genetic material is DNA. Okay, if you expand it, it is referred to as deoxyribonucleic acid. Based on how this genetic material is organized within a cell, we can classify cell into two types. They are the prokaryotic cell and the eukaryotic cell. Now, this term prokaryotic, like was eukaryotic, now this has been derived from two Greek words. Now, pro here refers to before. Pro here refers to before, and here the term carrion refers to, or it means kernel. Now what is kernel? Kernel means the central or the very important part of something. Okay, and we know this kernel here refers to the nucleus. Okay, so this is the meaning of the term prokaryotes. Pro here refers to before. Carrion comes from the term, or the meaning of the term is kernel, which means here nucleus. So these are those cells where there won't be any nucleus. This is something prior to the formation of nucleus, where nucleus was not there. Okay, whereas when we talk about eukaryotic cell, here means true. And likewise, as I told you, carry on means kernel, which here we are referring to, which we are referring to nucleus. So these are those cells where there would be presence of a true and a complete nucleus. Whereas prokaryotes or prokaryotic prokaryotic cells are those cells where there won't be nucleus, or it is just in the beginning or the developing stage. We know that when life originated on the earth, there were first the prokaryotic cells, and they didn't have a well-defined nucleus. Okay, so let us further understand about this prokaryotic cell and eukaryotic cell. As I told you, in eukaryotes, now who are eukaryotes? Eukaryotes are those organisms which will be having eukaryotic cell. That is, those organisms which are having a well-defined nucleus. That is, their genetic material would be enclosed in a special compartment called as nucleus. And this nucleus would be in turn covered by a membrane, which is referred to as a nuclear membrane. So you can see here, so this is the genetic material. This is the genetic material over here, the DNA. You know that DNA is double stranded structure. So this is the double hand structure, which is in the helical form. Now remember children, this DNA is a very long molecule, and it is very difficult to accommodate such a long molecule inside a very small space referred to as the nucleus. So what happens is, this DNA gets coiled, and with the help of special proteins. In case of eukaryotes, this coiling takes place with the help of special proteins which are referred to as histones. So this coiling takes place with the help of special proteins called as histones. Okay, so they coil and they form something called as the chromatin fibers. They coil and form the chromatin fibers. Okay, so when the cell is not dividing, what will you find is, inside the nucleus, this DNA will be coiled in the form of fine network or form fibers, which are referred to as chromatin fibers, which may further condense and form chromosome during cell division. So when the cell is about to divide, so you can see here the picture is of a cell which is about to divide, and that is why you can see the chromatin fiber is further condensed to form the chromosome. This is how the genetic material is arranged in the eukaryotic cell. So in a eukaryotic cell, the DNA or the genetic material is present in a well-defined space which is referred to as a nucleus. It is having a membrane called the nuclear membrane, and the genetic material is coiled with the help of special proteins called histones, and they form chromatin fibers when the cell is not dividing, and further they condense and form chromosomes during cell division. Talking about the next type of cell, the next type of cell are the prokaryotic cell. Okay, and those organisms which have that sort of cells are referred to as the prokaryotes. Now in the prokaryotes, the genetic material is simply lying freely in the cytoplasm as coil structure, which is referred to as the nucleoid. Understand the term nucleoid, also referred to as incipient nucleus. Incipient here refers to beginning to happen or beginning to develop. So they have not formed a nucleus over here. So here you can see the inside the cytoplasm, the genetic material here, the genetic material again is the DNA, which is again coiled, but this time this coiling is not done by histones. Okay, so this time this coiling is not done by histones here. So they coil and lying freely in the cytoplasm to form a structure called as nucleoid. So this structure here is referred to as nucleoid, also referred to as the incipient nucleus. I hope that is clear to you, the difference between a eukaryotic and prokaryotic cell based on the organization of the genetic material. This is very important and you should understand it clearly. Moving on to the next component, the third most important component of a cell is the cytoplasm. So what were the other two components that we have learned? We learned about the outer envelope. Secondly, we learned about the genetic material. Now third and the final one, the cytoplasm. Every cell will contain cytoplasm. Now what is cytoplasm? A cytoplasm is a semi-fluid matrix that occupies the interior of the cell. So the interior of the cell contains a semi-fluid matrix, and that matrix is referred to as the cytoplasm. What is the function of the cytoplasm? It is a main arena of cellular or life activities which keeps the cell in the living state. So it is the place in the cell where all metabolic activities or all chemical reactions takes place in order to maintain the cell in the living state. Now let us see further what the cytoplasm contains. Now the cytoplasm contains the following things. They are the cytosol, the cell organelles, and cell inclusion. Now what is the cytosol? The cytosol is also referred to as the intracellular fluid. So it is a fluid component of the cytoplasm. It is a fluid component of the cytoplasm. Mainly it comprises of water. 70 to 80% of this cytosol will be comprising of water. It comprises of numerous ions and also comprises of numerous other biomolecules, both micro as well as macromolecules. That is, it contains numerous organic molecules, both smaller and bigger. Like it may contain amino acids, it may contain carbohydrates of different types. Okay, so it may contain lipids, fats, all these. So they are it's a intracellular fluid. So the fluid component is referred to as the cytosol, and the main component of it being water. Along with that, it contains ions and other micro and macro molecules. Then comes the cell organelles. The cell organelles are subcellular structures present inside the cytosol. Okay, and they are doing specific functions. So they are living structures. They are living structures present inside the cytoplasm. Living structures usually bounded by membrane. Sometimes they may not have membrane also. Usually they are bounded by membrane, and they perform important functions. Okay, and finally we have cell inclusions. Cell inclusions are actually non-living structures present within the cytoplasm. Okay, they are not bounded by membrane. They are not bounded by membrane. They are not bounded by membrane, and they are not involved in very important functions. Actually, they might be the result of the functions carried out by the cell organelles. Okay, or it might be some storage nutrients. Now, these cell inclusions include some storage nutrients, like in some cells nutrients may be stored in the form of glycogen, some it may be stored in the form of starch. These are referred to as storage nutrients. Okay, likewise so it may include storage nutrients, some pigment granules, okay, so storage nutrients, pigment granules, etc. are referred to as cell inclusions. They are non-living structures, not bounded by membrane, and they may be the product of the functions. They may be the product of the functions done by the cell organelles. Okay, so again, cytoplasm comprises of three important things: the cytosol, cell organelles, cell inclusions. Okay, cytosol refers to the intracellular fluid. Then These are subcellular living structures which perform important functions. Bounded may or may not be bounded by membrane, whereas cell inclusions are non-living structures not bounded by membrane, which refers to like storage nutrients, some pigment granules, crystals of some kind. Okay, so that is all about the cytoplasm. Now let us further understand about the cell organelles. Now, as I told you, cell organelles are actually the subcellular structures found in the cytoplasm, which carry important functions of life. Okay, now they can be further classified into three types based on the presence or absence of membrane. Okay, so they can either be membraneless. So some organelles are membraneless. Membraneless means won't be having a membrane. They won't be bounded by a membrane. Okay, likewise we may have organelles which may be bounded by a membrane, but that is single membrane. There may be organelles which may be bounded by two membranes, or double membrane bound structures or cell organelles are there. So which are the membraneless cell organelles? Membraneless cell organelles include the ribosomes and the centrioles. Ribosomes and centrioles. Remember, centrioles are found only in animal cells. Plant cells won't be having centrioles. Single membrane bound cell organelles are endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi complex, lysosomes and microbodies. Double membrane bound structures or covered cell organelles are mitochondria and plastids. Okay, plastids like chloroplast, chromoplast, these plastids are found in plants only, whereas mitochondria would be found in all cell types. Okay, so they are, so these two are the cell organelles which have or which are bounded by double membrane. Okay, so that was all about the brief summary of the cell structure. Okay, now let us talk about the other different aspects related to cell. Now, cell shows lot of diversity in shape, size. So here let us discuss about cell shape. Okay, in multicellular organisms we know that they are made up of different kinds of cells, and each cell will be different from each other, and this difference in shape may be because on the functions that it does, or maybe based on the position in the body. Okay, so I'm taking few examples of some cells, okay, and their shape based on the function that they are doing. So here you have some examples. Now this here is the RBC cells. You can see RBC cells. What is their shape? Circular and biconcave. Now why do they have this shape, circular and biconcave? So when they assume a biconcave shape, they are actually having a large surface area. So this allows them to transport large amount of oxygen. At the same time, this shape helps them to move easily through the fine blood capillaries. Then you can see this is the amoeboid WBC. The shape of white blood cells is usually amoeboid. Amoeboid, you know, amoeba-like. No, that is, they do not have a specific shape. Okay, now why is the shape, why are they having this particular amoeboid shape? So that they can easily squeeze to the fine blood capillaries and do phagocytosis. I hope you understand phagocytosis. Phagocytosis is to engulf the foreign substances that enter into our body and protect and give us protection. Okay, then we have, now this is the, these two were the animal cells that I was talking about. Then this, cells that you see over here, this one, guard cells. Okay, these guard cells is reniform. Reniform means kidney shape. Okay, now here they are in the shape, and remember, one side, one wall of the cell would be much more thicker as compared to the other side. So this helps the shape of the guard cells, enable them to expand and contract laterally, allowing the stomata to be open or closed. Next on the screen, there are few more cell shapes. Here these are the long and narrow columnar epithelial cells. These are present in the linings of the intestines, and they are basically involved in absorption of nutrients. Okay, now these are branched and long nerve cells. This is the nerve cell, they are branched and long. Now why they are so branched and long? Their function is to conduct impulses from different parts of the body to the brain and vice versa. Then we have the sperm cells, which are very small. Okay, sperm cells are very small size cells, and they're very small and motile. Then the egg cell would be comparatively larger. Why they're larger and spherical? So that they can accommodate more nutrients. So they may not accommodate nutrients. Their only function is to just reach the ovum and cause fertilization, for which they are small and motile. Now these two cells are found in plants, which are the tracheids and mesophyll cells. Now tracheids, see the shape of tracheids, they are elongated cells. Now what is the function, why are they elongated? Remember, tracheids are at maturity dead cell. They are devoid of protoplasm, they do not have protoplasm, and so their function is to mainly conduct water and minerals, and likewise they also provide mechanical support to the plant. Okay, so they have a strong cell wall also. Now mesophyll cells, as you know, they are found in the leaf. Okay, and they are spherical, or they are round and oval in shape, and they are filled with chloroplast. And why they are of this shape is so that they can accommodate more chloroplast and get proper protection from the intensity of sunlight, protect the chloroplast from high intense sunlight. So that was about the cell shape. Now next is cell size. Okay, cell also show a lot of diversity in size also. Now mycoplasma comes under Kingdom Monera. Mycoplasma is the smallest cell, okay, and which is 0.3 micrometer in length. Micrometer, 1 micrometer is equal to 10 raised to power minus 6 meter. Okay, so micrometer is 1 millionth of a meter. So that, so very small is are the mycoplasma. So they are one of the smallest cells. Now, bacteria could be a bit more bigger, that is 3 to 5 micrometer. The largest cell is the egg of an ostrich. Now in the human body, the largest cell is the ovum, the smallest being the sperm cells, and the nerve cells being the longest cells. Human red blood cells are about 7 micrometer in diameter. So that is about the cell size of different cells. Preferably, all the metabolically active cell would be smaller in size. We know as the organism gets bigger and bigger, we know that the cell do not increase in size. Instead, these organisms will be having many cells of smaller size. So, in order to be metabolically active, the cells should be smaller in size. Why? Because when they are smaller in size, they'll be having more surface area as compared to their volume. Okay? And so, why is that required? Why they need to be in smaller in sizes? When they have a smaller volume as compared to surface area, so when smaller volume as compared to surface area, what is happening is they will get better nuclear control over the metabolism. Okay, so that is one important thing. They will get a better nuclear control over metabolism due to higher nucleocytoplasmic ratio. Similarly, when they have a larger surface area, it will be easy for the cell to allow the intake of nutrients and oxygen at a faster rate. Likewise, waste and carbon dioxide can be disposed quickly. So as the cell size increase, what will happen? The nuclear control over the cell will decrease, over the metabolism will decrease. Secondly, the surface area will reduce, and therefore, since the volume is more, the amount of nutrient intake and oxygen requirement will be quite high. But the surface being very less, so that process would be slower. Similarly, the other process like disposing the waste won't be happening very fast. That is about the cell size. So cell size should be preferably smaller in order to be more metabolically active. Okay, next is lifespan of cells. What about the lifespan of cell? Every cell would be having a specific lifespan, and that depends upon the genetic clock of cells. This is already programmed in the cells, already present. That information is already present in the genetic material. And it, other than the genetic clock, it also is determined by the environmental conditions in which the cell is present. Okay? And so when the cells are dying, so who will be replacing them? So this will be replaced by the division of undifferentiated cells. Undifferentiated means immature cells, like stem cells in humans, meristematic cells in plants. So these are undifferentiated or immature cells which have the ability to give rise to new cells when the older cells have died. Now I have written, I mentioned some two cells over here whose lifespan is, for example, RBC's lifespan is about 120 days. Human WBC's lifespan is between 13 to 20 days. And the genetically controlled cell death is called as apoptosis. I'll repeat, the genetically controlled cell death is called apoptosis.